This is the China in Depth. Today is April 13, 2023. This article is from Wall Street Journal. China seeks to write its own history of battle with COVID-19. The article said, 2 months after declaring victory over COVID-19, Beijing is withholding data on its impact and censoring people who contradict the government line that its handling of the virus was a triumph. Official reports on the number of bodies cremated have disappeared or not been updated in more than 30 provinces, cities, or districts. Authorities have been censoring discussions on social media about the long-term psychological toll of the zero-COVID policy and shutting down commemorations of the first anniversary of the months-long lockdowns. Companies have avoided mentioning the pandemic or the virus by name in annual reports, blaming business disruptions on a sudden public health incident or unexpected events. The Communist Party has scrubbed the histories of other events in China's past by controlling information about them. Beijing's efforts to shape public memories of its COVID policies is emblematic of how the Communist Party is unwilling to fully reckon with the past when it makes the party look bad, according to historian Gina Tam. Beijing has been promoting that their leadership's decisions over the 3 years of the pandemic were absolutely correct and recognized by the people, according to a speech from leader Xi Jinping. People's Daily, the official party newspaper, published a series of commentaries defending China's decision to reopen, claiming they had enough medical resources before making the decision. Most people in China are happy to be moving on and support the government for keeping deaths to a minimum throughout the pandemic. Even though the total death toll is unknown, epidemiologists believe the mortality rate was lower than the US and other big countries. Social media used to praise China's handling of the pandemic, but recently the public has been indifferent or mocking the party's obsession with victory. People in Shanghai have started to repost lockdown notices they received a year ago and share blunt messages of not forgetting what happened. A Shanghai lawyer recalled being kept in her building last April by a gatekeeper that lived in his car. People are not able to forget what happened, and it is uncertain if the next generation will be able to. The death toll in China is highly contested, with international health experts calling for more data from Beijing. Estimates of 1 to 1.5 million deaths due to COVID-19 have been made by epidemiologists, while Chinese health authorities report 84,000 deaths. Lack of data on cremations has made it difficult to reach a more complete estimate. Civil affairs departments typically report cremation numbers, but the data was left blank in more than a dozen municipalities for the fourth quarter of 2022. Nanjing, a provincial capital of nearly 10 million, removed cremation data sections from every published report dating back to the first quarter of 2020. Other places have postponed the delivery of their reports with no details on when the data will be available. China's Civil Affairs Ministry and Nanjing authorities did not respond to requests for comment. President Xi praised China's remarkable feat in successfully walking out of the pandemic with the lowest mortality rate globally. Guo Jing, a social worker and women's rights activist, was asked to hand over a manuscript she published and surveillance cameras were placed outside her apartment. During the anniversary of the Shanghai lockdown, a resident's WeChat post was no longer accessible and those who purchased a t-shirt with the words "Shanghai Lockdown Survivor" were questioned by the police. Kathy Lin, another Shanghai resident, was locked down in a 90-square-foot room for 2 months, including her 30th birthday. She and her friends are still angry and dismissed the government's assessment that it handled the virus correctly. Guo Jing, before leaving China, watched neon-colored propaganda slogans projected onto skyscrapers celebrating the victorious and heroic city. She was saddened when she heard a little girl reciting the slogans, as she may not understand what the lockdown meant. This article is from Foreign Affairs. What's really going on between Russia and China? The article said, Xi Jinping's last month visit to Russia was a demonstration of public support for the embattled Russian leader. Xi and Putin made a number of important decisions about the future of Chinese-Russian defense cooperation and likely came to terms on arms deals. The war in Ukraine and ensuing Western sanctions on Russia are reducing the Kremlin's options and pushing Russia's economic and technological dependence on China to unprecedented levels. Senior figures in the Chinese Communist Party have openly discussed the need for a closer partnership with Russia because of what they perceive as an increasingly hostile U.S. policy aimed at containing China's rise. Xi's trip was to show China sees many benefits in its relationship with Russia, it will continue to maintain those ties at the highest level, and it will not be deterred by Western critics. China presented a position paper on the Ukrainian crisis, a laundry list of talking points, as window dressing for Xi's visit. The real action took place behind the scenes in private negotiations between Putin and Xi. The two leaders likely discussed arms deals and cooperation for defense. The Chinese-Russian partnership is seen as a way for both countries to push back against the US and its allies. At the conclusion of the trip, the Kremlin published a list of 14 documents signed by both China and Russia, which at first glance appeared to be insignificant memorandums between ministries. However, when looking more closely, many of the officials present at the talks were involved in Russia's weapons and space programs. It is likely that the two countries were discussing deeper defense cooperation. China and Russia have not made any new deals public, but have done this in the past. After the U.S. Congress passed the Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act in 2017, Beijing and Moscow stopped disclosing their military contracts. Russia has been reluctant to sell cutting-edge military technology to China in the past, but since the breakdown in ties with the West, this has changed. China has relied on Russian military hardware since the 1990s, but now has its own military industry. Nevertheless, Beijing still wants access to Russian technology for surface-to-air missiles, fighter jet engines, and underwater warfare equipment. To modernize its own industry, Russia has started integrating its research facilities with Chinese partners and opening up universities and science institutes to Chinese partners. The Xi-Putin summit discussed how Russian companies could gain better access to the Chinese financial system and expanding the sale of Russian natural resources to China. Beijing has no interest in drawing attention to such deals, since China has many potential sellers, whereas Russia has few potential buyers. The yuan is becoming Russia's preferred currency for trade settlement, savings, and investments, making China an increasingly important partner for Russia. Beijing still needs Moscow, and the Kremlin can provide certain unique assets, purchases of advanced Russian weapons and military technology, freer access to Russian scientific talent, and the rich endowment of Russia's natural resources. Russia is an anti-American great power with a permanent seat on the UN Security Council, making them a convenient friend for China in a world where the United States has closer ties with many countries. Russia's size and power may give the Kremlin a false sense of security in their relationship with Beijing. The durability of this relationship will depend on China's ability to manage a weakening Russia. In the years to come, Putin's regime will have to learn how to manage upward in order to survive. This article is from New York Times. As US tries to isolate China, German companies move closer. The article said, Volkswagen and the chemical company BASF are expanding their investments in China despite US efforts to isolate the country economically. Volkswagen has announced plans to tailor models to Chinese customers' wishes and invest billions in local partnerships and production sites. BASF is investing 10 billion euros in a new chemical production complex. Volkswagen and BASF are aware of US efforts to isolate China, but argue that revenue from China is essential for their businesses to thrive and grow in Europe. BASF's chief executive stated that without the business in China, restructuring in Europe would not be possible. Volkswagen relies on sales from China to help underwrite operations in Europe. German lawmakers and business leaders are looking to strike a balance between diversifying ties with Asia and acknowledging the importance of doing business with China. Germany depends on China to provide essential technology products and raw materials, which are critical to its plans to transition to cleaner energy and transportation. Reducing ties with China in the short term is not a reasonable option due to the great dependencies. The European Union has had a tumultuous relationship with China, with a trade and investment deal that was approved in 2020, only to be shelved shortly after due to sanctions imposed on EU lawmakers. Last week, Ursula von der Leyen, President of the European Commission, traveled to Beijing to try to rebalance economic ties with China. She called for the revival of talks about trade, but noted the restrictions China places on foreign companies. China has been Germany's biggest trading partner for 7 years in a row, but Germany has experienced an increasingly lopsided trade deficit. German automakers have traditionally dominated the Chinese market, but domestically produced electric vehicles are now surging in popularity. Chinese electric brands are now entering the German market, threatening German automakers on their home territory. Volkswagen's chief executive has vowed to strengthen his company's partnerships in China. A study by the Kiel Institute showed that decoupling from China would be very costly for Europe, but especially for Germany. Berlin would like to avoid another round of upheaval, meaning they must balance economic interests with security concerns. Jörg Kukies, an economic advisor to the German finance minister, stated the goal is to have a positive approach to China and not an anti-China approach. Thanks for watching and see you all in the next one.